senior engineering manager managing Coldfusion server and Coldfusion builder, has worked on CF8, CF9 and first version of CF builder. He possesses several years of R&D experience in application server internals and internet architectures, and wrote world's first EJB 2.0 container when he was at Prometheus Technologies. He was part of expert group committee for J2EE, EJB 2.0, EJB 3.0 specification. He has spoken at various conferences including Java 1, WebDU, RIACon, CF United, NCD DevCon, and Adobe Max conferences. He is passionate about Coldfusion and the role it plays in making hard things easy. He can be reached on Twitter at @kandelwar.
Okay, thanks. I hope you guys had a great coffee, tea break, and all settled for this next session. If you're part of previous two sessions, so I think those two sessions kind of lay some of the foundations for this session. Just a quick introduction about myself. I'm not a security expert, so some of the previous talks were more about, you know, application security and other things, but I'm actually on the other side, you know, how I am looking at my product, the product that I manage, and what is that I have done to improve the security. So, and I'm going to share those perspectives and the practices that I have adopted to make security better for my product. So it's more a practical approach, an approach that right now I'm doing. So whatever I'm presenting is actually something that is real in action. It's not like there's no gyan, I mean, it appears so. But it's mostly about things in action right now. So quick introduction about myself. I'm senior engineering manager with Adobe, managing a couple of web server related products. And I was part of the expert group member committee for J2 1.4 specification and EJB 2.1 and 3.2 specification. Alright, so what I really want to cover is why security is important. I will briefly touch upon that, and I'm going to touch upon this mostly from a business perspective, because why I'm even making certain investment in security, right? Like, why is security important, and also why is security becoming an important at the organization level as well. The next one is, obviously, if you know security is important, what is the desired level of security that you want in your product? Do you want to stay ahead? Do you want to stay behind? And the third aspect is, what's your current grade? You know, where do you stand? Where your product or project that you are working on really stand? How do you assess it, right? Whether it's a pass or a fail product, right? Simple Boolean. Once we talk about these three aspects, then we'll talk about some of the processes to make security in a product. I'm not going to go very deep into some of the security algorithms and that kind of stuff, but more related to actionable items that are applied at a project level or a product level. So security is important, we all understand, but let us look at, you know, what are some of the important factors or some of the risks that are associated if an organization don't pay attention to security. I think the most important is the brand. There's a severe brand risk. If you know that Microsoft does not produce secure product, I mean, their business will just go for a toss. Right? It's pure brand perception. Regulatory, which is again very important. Data privacy is becoming very important, and PCI, right? If you are using a product to create an e-commerce based website, and if you are not following a PCI standard, you know, it's difficult, right? No one is going to give you credit card information. And the third most important factor that business looks at is revenue, right? I can lose enterprise customers. Adobe, in my case, Adobe can easily lose their big enterprise customers, like that is millions of dollars in revenue. And this case actually happened with one of the product that I was managing. We have a federal agency in US government, and they found a security vulnerability. We were poor in responding back, and that was an incident that happened 2 years ago. Even today, when the salespeople go and approach that company, they actually give reference to that case and say, look at your security. And it's always a fighting case for us. Just a small incident that we could have handled much better, but every time we have to fight for the dollars with our customers, so it's very, very important. And obviously, customers will find alternatives. And just to give you a sense of brand or overall, every one of you will have some perception. Maybe you will have some data to back this up, but which browser is most secure? I'm not trying to recommend any. I may not even have the right data, but we all have our own perception and sense of which company is providing good security or which product is secure enough. So it really becomes very important. It plays in your mind when you make a buying decision. Right, so the next thing is, if security is important, what is the desired level of security that you want in a product? Obviously, if you look at incidents, the response and other things, it's mostly reactive, right? You're behind, but you really want to be ahead. And I've got this nice little graph just to say, the magnitude of perception of security over time, right? So the red curve reflects, what is the perception that people are forming about your project or your brand. If you have a product that is over a longer period of time, their perception of the problems with security is growing. Why? Because the response is reactive, right? Because you respond, but the perception has increased beyond the response that you are providing. What you really want to be is here, right? That's a desired level of security that you want, where you are ahead in responding to the security problems that people are facing, right? And that's the only way to actually bring back or bring down the external perception of a problem. We are going to discuss a bunch of activities that we are applying in our project, how to actually bring this down. And you have to have a constant response mechanism to really bring it down. And this is what I call more as a proactive approach, right? It's not just like if a CV is reported, you fix that and be done with that. But it's more about, what are the additional effort that you are doing to bring down or improve the security of your product, including perception. So how do you assess, right? How do you assess security? I want to ask this question to people, like, how do they currently assess security of a project that they are working on, or security of product, or what is the mechanism that they follow? Anyone wants to go? Share his thoughts.
Maybe by running VAPT.
By running VAPT, like, yeah, it's a, right? So that's one mechanism. That's the right answer, so you...
Will for auditing.
Yeah, right. Right, that is for auditing. Anyone else? I mean, that definitely covers one dimension of how do you access.
Compliance
testing. Compliance testing, right. So what I'm trying to drive the point is that there are various categories that you can define, and you need not restrict to the categories that I am going to show, but define certain categories so that you can actually grade the security of the project or the product that you are working on, and you can exactly talk about this. And let me show you something. I didn't want it to be quiz time, but anyway. So these are the four categories, and this is the input also coming from Adobe's centralized product security team. These are the four major categories that we look at for our product. Threat, like, I'm going to talk in detail about each of them. The first one is threat landscape analysis. The second one is what is the level of application security. The third one is what is the mechanism of deployment and updates, how do you send out the patch. And the fourth most important, and we as developers or hackers, we actually tend to forget about that, customer communication is very, very important. Remember the curve that I showed earlier? It's the perception that matters a lot, and you need to, while you are improving the security of your product, you need to improve the perception about your product, because that's when the branding and everything else comes into picture. It's not just sufficient to improve security alone. So we're going to look at all these four aspects. So the first one is the threat landscape analysis. And that is really how do you account for changing landscape with new and varied attack practice. You know, they keep on changing. You know, like there are always new form of attack that people are devising, that people, some of you, people like you are devising. And the companies needs to respond, the product, the project, they need to respond to those attack vectors. And threat landscape analysis is really about looking at those attack vectors, intelligence gathering, and how do you process those issues. You know, this is mostly responsive, reactive. You know, how do you respond to those issues, and also about training. Is your staff sufficiently trained about the new attacks that are happening? Application security is really about what is your product design. You know, what are the APIs that are there? Are there enough secure APIs? What is the status of legacy code? What is the testing methodology? And I think you were describing that. What is the testing methodology that you use? Security audit, you know, what kind of security audit is there? And what is the documentation? You know, if you have a secure flag in your product, is it sufficiently documented? Can people discover it? So it's all about application security. And just to remind you, these are the classification under which you can actually grade up, grade the security of your product, and I'll show it to you also. The third one is deployment and updates. So it's about process related to secure installation and maintenance. If you have built a patch, how do you deliver it to your customers? You know, is there a regular patch mechanism that exists? Sure.
So in the previous slide, what is the legacy code?
Right. So legacy code, for example, let's say you have a product from Adobe, or let's say Flash Player or Acrobat, Adobe Reader, right? Now, right now the version of Adobe Reader is 10, right? So there must be, so Adobe Reader would have added some code for version 3, version 4, version 5, but they want the PDF created at those time to be still be viewable in the latest version. So there might be some legacy code that is still around, and that legacy code, it's like, okay, it was there, it's working, no one is actively working on it, so we're never going to touch that. But you can have security holes in the legacy code, isn't it? Right. So product companies typically face more issues around legacy code than projects, because the duration, like Reader is, Acrobat is around for a very long time. Right? So there is a lot of code that was written in version 1 that actually still works today. But no one is actually actively working on that, so there might be something you need to do about that. And that's part of application security. It's really more internal to how the product is built. Our deployment and updates, it's all about installation and maintenance. How do customers get security patches? What is your zero-day response policies? Do you ship regular patches? Some companies actually are very good in having every Tuesday of a quarter, first Tuesday of a quarter, and stuff like that. So that makes, if I'm a system administrator, I know, okay, there is a patch coming out. So my perception of the security is definitely better. And then are there enough configurations? If you have an UI or administrator interface, can you actually set up security settings? And then customer communication, very, very important in my opinion. It's all related to outbound communication on risk mitigation. You know, it's like, for example, if you call customer support for, let's say, you know, you have issue with your Airtel phone, or I don't know, whichever phone you're using. And actually, if the guy on the other side tries to calm you down and help you explain the problem, even though he's offering no solution right now, but if he, you know, communicates well, what is the problem, what is the analysis of problem, what are the, you know, potential solution possible, and if he gives you a firm date, if he tells you, okay, we have listened to your problem, within 2 weeks we'll be able to fix your problem, you're going to be a happy customer, compared to you call Airtel and say, we don't know about this problem, when we release, we'll tell you. Obviously, there's a degree of difference between the two communications that has happened over here. It's the same problem with security. There are many security vulnerabilities that you can't fix in a day, right? You can't fix in a week's time, but providing the information, communication back to customers is very, very important about what we are doing. And that's why security bulletins are important. I don't know if you guys have blogs, and I'm not talking about a new security geekiness that you have discovered in writing about blogs. That's totally separate, but more about outbound customer communication, about explaining an issue that they have faced, they have reported, or talking more about a fix, or even telling them, you know, how the entire process is working. So it's more from that perspective. And the last point is public relation, very important, because you have to analyze whether the perception of security is decreasing. All your efforts are only useful if your customers know that the perception of security is decreasing, right? So communication is very, very important. It is often not used. Maybe I come from the other side. I'm not so much, you know, I'm not a security expert, but this is how I look at security. You know, what is the benefit that it is providing if I invest in it? Is it going to improve the perception of my product? So these are the grades that you can use for each of the four categories that I described. You know, threat landscape analysis, application security, deployment and updates, and you can actually grade like a subject each one of those, whether you are an industry leader in that segment, or if you are ahead of the curve, or you have adequate amount of security, or you have some gaps preventing full adoption of industry best practices, and F for failing. And don't be shy, you know, using these grades. And in a professional environment, grading becomes, you know, grading does help you, because it's like you're not trying to say it depends. You know, if someone asks you like what is the status of application security, you're not saying like it depends. You're saying that we are at grade D. Simple. Like, you have analyzed based on whatever parameters, metrics you have used, and then you say that I want to improve, right? If you're grade D, obviously you need to improve. C might be a little adequate, but it depends on, see, I'm using it depends. You need to determine, you know, whether a grade C is adequate, or whether it fits with the short-term plan or your long-term plans. Any questions so far? So these are the three things that I wanted to describe before we move into some of the processes that we have followed to improve the security in one of the products that I'm handling. So yeah, that's what, identify section-wise and overall grade for your project and product. It becomes very, very clear-cut objective. There is no subjectivity. You can define more categories. You can say, I want to have six categories. Fair enough. So you define, and then say, okay, this is my plan to improve. And that's what it is, right? Once you have an objectivity saying that, you know, it's a grade D product, or it's a grade F product, then obviously you need to have a plan to bake in security in your product, right? Because you want to improve grades. Maybe you want to have short-term target of grade B or C, and then you say long-term target is grade A or something like that. And we have actually done that, so I cannot tell you the grades, but this is exact same process that we have followed. I know the past grade of the project product that I'm talking about, and I know what is the desired grade that I want to achieve. And that's how this process came into being. So it's the same process that we followed that I'm describing. So the question is how to secure good grades, right? How to make security in your product. And we came up with plans at two levels, organization level plan and the team level plan. And organization level plan was really driven more centrally, because products like Flash Player, Adobe Reader, and a bunch of other products are also Shockwave, and a bunch of other things were already impacted. So there were more. There was more uniformity in the plan that was followed at the organization level. So at the organization level, there was a there was a lot more focus that was given to a centralized security team. I'm putting Adobe as an example because I know about it a lot more than Microsoft's centralized security team, for example. We call it Adobe Secure Software Engineering Team. It's a team of privacy and security experts, real hardcore security geeks. Some of them are from AdStack and a lot of very credible companies. So they do provide help on best practices. They do provide help on incident responses. And also, they are very active in industry consortiums like OWASP and others that you might be aware of. To me, of all these things, the most important is the last piece, which is how do they interact with the product team, right? Like, what is my interaction with the centralized security team on improving the product? And that happens through SPLC, which is a secure product lifecycle. So this is how we work out. So they help in design, engineering, and validation of the product. And SPLC, which is Secure Product Lifecycle, it is really about a set of multiple steps where the central security team interacts with the development team to really come up with a plan and understanding of how to deal with security overall. So the first and most important step is training and certification. And I'm going to talk about what are the specific things that we did as a development team on training and certification. Very important step of an SPLC process. SPLC is Secure Product Lifecycle. The next one was planning, and we discussed a little bit about that during grading. So it's nothing but essentially grading your product. You know, what is the grade that you want to give to your product? The next one is design. So it's about the security architecture, design review, and what's the application security. You know, what are the APIs and what is the product architecture and design. So there's an interesting story on threat modeling, and a few years ago, our centralized security team, I was going through this process, and they asked me like, okay, can you do a threat model for the product? I said, what? Threat model? I mean, sorry, but I heard that term for the first time, and I said like, what's a threat model? Like, what am I going to do about threat model? And then, funnily, the guy who I was talking to, he said like, can you draw circles and boxes? I said, I can do that. Can you draw a high level view of the product on a blackboard or on a whiteboard? I said, I can do that. So that's what threat model is all about. And I'm going to show you the exact picture of, it looks like a molecular biology though. But this is the threat model that I drew. And I realized that if you are a senior technical member on the team, if you're a product architecture, it's really just laying down the data flow diagram and the big boxes that contains, you know, some logical connected piece of entity. You know, it's no rocket science. And I mean, first time I was threatened by the threat model, but later on I realized like it's not such a big deal to do that. So there's very, very important. And once you have a threat model, it becomes very easy to keep on updating it and keep on adding it. So it's you can see one of the product that I manage is Cold Fusion. So it's a threat model for Cold Fusion that I did. And it is essentially, you know, the double circle, this one is. This is like total internal communication area, right? There is nothing that is going outside the boundary, right? And then the dotted lines are your sandbox layers, right? So you can see there's a flash player inbound communication happening. There's a web browser. There is a bunch of other remote data source connectivity stuff. I mean, what I'm saying is, this is very, very, this was something that you know, if you talk to a senior person on the team or a product architecture, they're very easily able to do that. You ask them to do a whiteboard diagram of, you know, to draw an architecture diagram of the feature that you are doing, then they'll easily do that. You have to just capture the same thing in your threat model. So that's the story on threat model. And then obviously you get into the implementation phase where you need to start implementing some of the areas that you have identified to improve the security on your product. The next one is testing, and testing can be both ways. It can be based on the next version that you are building, or it can be more proactive testing where you say these are the areas that I need to identify, and there are a lot of mechanisms that you can use for secure testing. But I'm generally talking about the phases where the central security team was interacting with the product team to come up with, you know, what are the various steps in the product lifecycle, secure product lifecycle that you need to do. And then obviously before you ship, there is a security. Sorry. Yes. First testing is when you use random inputs to attack. Someone can explain me much better than me on first testing. Please feel free to do so. Yes, it's mostly like that, but it's like you have each file first, and there are a lot of stuff where you actually create random inputs and then attack. It's slightly different from other forms, but it's more like a random set of data that is being used. Readiness, so we do a ship readiness review before we ship a product, and it's a security readiness review that is run by the security team, so you can't escape, right? So you need to make sure that, you know, there is a readiness review that is already done. So some of the suggestions that they have provided during the SPLC cycle are taken care of. And I think, again, I will go back to the response plan. Again, very important, you discuss that, you know, what is going to be the response plan on various features. You know, if there is a security vulnerability that is reported, how you are going to respond to that, and what are the documentation, security white papers and other stuff that you are going to use. And the final phase is response, which is post-ship. What is, how are you shipping patches, and what is the update management plan? So these are the seven stages of SPLC, and so these are, you know, more at a recommended level to all product teams. And let's dive into what is the strategy that we adopted for the product, and what did we really do. So these are the team level strategy that we adopted to improve security of the product. So I call it a three-pronged strategy. The first one is the product enhancements that we did around security, the process improvements that we did around security, and the third is delivery and notification mechanism. And to be honest, for the product that we were looking into, I was very, very bad, the delivery and notification mechanism, and that actually helped us solve a lot of problems, made our customers happy. And what we also did was, on orthogonal axis, we decided that we will have some short-term goals and some long-term goals, because you can't do everything in short-term, you can't do everything in a long-term, right? And I think the previous presenter, Ketan Vyas, was describing, you know, there is an money involved here, right? I have to decide, you know, how much investment I'm ready to make, right? So obviously I'll say, okay, these are the immediate targets, short term, and obviously this you work out along with input from security team also, because there's a triaging process that is also involved, you know, what is important right now versus what is going to be important a little bit later on. So so we decided both short-term, long-term plans and the same. So I'm going to take the short-term and long-term. I'll probably sporadically mention about them, but let's focus on these three strategies that we adopted. Any questions so far?
Can you talk about product enhancements? What kind of strategy are you looking at for product enhancements?
Sure. I'll cover in the next slide. I'll take up that question. But essentially, and I'm coming from, it's not a project, right? I'm coming from a product background. So we continue to deliver versions of product, right? Version 8, version 9. So if I started working on my strategy on product enhancement in version 8, I'm saying that what are the security features that I'm going to build in version 9? So those are product enhancements. Yes, that's right. Yes, and some of it you can do right now. Like if you are shipping an updater or a service pack, you say that's part of my short-term goal. So the product enhancement short-term goal is fix these five set of bugs and provide one enhancement, right? But long-term goal is maybe I need to change my architecture, right? I need to change the design of the product, so I need to invest more. So those are this. So I'm trying to separate out product-related stuff from process-related stuff and the delivery and notification, so that, you know, it becomes very easy to focus on each one of them and then decide how to go about it. Any other question? Right. So product enhancements, to be very precise and specific, these are some of the short-term examples. What can be a short-term product enhancements versus what could be long-term product enhancements? For example, improve encryption, some low-hanging fruit, right? Maybe you are using low bits for encryption, you change to high bits, you know, you can always figure out some low-hanging fruit. You can make some improvement around cookie session handling, some amount of cross-site scripting, CSRF, critical security bug fix that are reported. So installer signing, and this is very, very important, that was very easy to do also, that we have security checklist for every feature that we sign on. Doesn't matter what is the size of the feature. So because when we say this product is ready to, this feature is ready to be shipped, obviously you work on multiple features, right? So at different stages, different features are available ready to be shipped, right? So they have to go through security checklist. Otherwise, they cannot be signed off. You know, the developers and QE working on that feature, they cannot move on to their next feature unless it is signed off. And we designed a security checklist to make sure that, you know, those are implementable guidelines, or if there is work that is required to be done later on, there is some amount of tracking that is going to happen. And also we established a code review process. Sometimes it's very difficult also, but we try to make sure that some of the code review process actually happen. In the process improvement, I'll tell you how we actually made the code review process work also. I'll quickly talk about that. Long-term examples, secure by default configuration. You know, we want to create a version that is can be installed by secure, so all security flags are turned on. Stronger encryption, architectural changes because of which you have been always punting, right? Okay, I can't do this release because I need to change the design or I need to change the architecture. So those are some of the decisions that can go in long term. And also long term, you can actually decide what you do about all the security bugs that have been reported, independent of their priorities and other things, but at least have a plan to address those. Or to say we'll never address those, but no in-between situation. The second one, team process improvement. So we actually did quite a bit. It was tough. It wasn't easy. We have to actually go through this over a period of time, hackle people nicely, politely, just to make sure that we are on track on these items. But this is where we get a lot of benefit from, and overall sense of awareness. And again, you can decide process improvements as a short-term objective or long-term objective. So let's look at team setup, training and certification, testing process, development process, security review, documentation, communication. And I want to emphasize again that we are actually doing all of this right now. So it's not something that's coming out of blue. It's something that we are trying to adopt. So, and this is giving us positive results. Obviously, scope for improvement, but not a bad start. So the most important decision that we took in terms of team setup, we have a dedicated security czar. In fact, Shilpi, who's the dedicated security czar on our product, she's actually here as well. So we said, like, it's not a part-time responsibility. On our product, security is not a part-time responsibility. It's a full-time responsibility. And because we follow a cyclone process, we have to have a security czar with a security QA. That's it. You know, it was a tough decision because I had to give away some features in favor of improving security, but that was a choice. You know, that I think very, very happy with that choice, I can tell you today. And instead of trying to hire someone and stuff like that, we actually asked one of our internship in this case, and she said, okay, I will take up that responsibility. And we're very good because she knows now the product as well as the security aspect. So it is working very beautifully for us. I've realized part-time does not work. You know, if you're serious about security, you've got to have a security person on the team, period. That's how it works. And then we also define process for reviewing security issues. Earlier, because there was no dedicated person, we have to like go to people who are actually experts in their areas and then talk to them, and it was like it was all lost somewhere. But having dedicated person itself allow us to have better processes in place. So we were able to create some process for reviewing security issues. And I was talking about the security checklist and other things and the code review process. We were actually able to achieve that because we have someone to actually dedicatedly look at those kind of things. The second thing that we did was training. Our central security team designed certification level, four security belts. They have named it with colors, I think white, green, brown, black. A lot of fun there with the colors, let's call it level 1 to level 4, and 100% of the team, including managers, have to clear level 1 security build, and they have to do it every year. Okay, it's not like I've once done, I've forgotten about it, and it's really easy, simple. I mean, with technology, you can easily create an online presentation with quizzes, right? It's no big deal. You create that, and everyone has to pass, easy. So it's not like, you know, we are expecting managers or QEs or developers to become, you know, security geeks. It's all about awareness, right? It's all about awareness. And the second thing is to have all the architects to have level 2 security belt and at least one level 3 and level 4 belt within the team. And obviously the degree of difficulty in attaining those belts increases with the level. So overall, good knowledge and good appreciation on security, awareness on security within the team. The next one on team process improvements was the testing process. Earlier on, we have very random ad hoc process to test, but now we have a full infrastructure set to test security. So we have stuff like Veracode, apps, scan, fuzzing, and a lot of other things. So we have a dedicated, because we have a dedicated security queue, right? So we have a dedicated testing process for security. We don't have to look outside or to anyone else really. A lot of changes in the development process. We started reviewing all reported security issues and said there will be no backlog on security issues. Because we include a lot of third-party libraries, so we said we will have some minimum standard policy. There's still a tricky area for us, not 100% sorted out, because we cannot really command, demand a lot of things from third-party libraries, but we need to figure that out. We also started going on a regular bug fix schedule so that, you know, there is a predictable improvement in the security. And then security bug markers, prioritization, and all those triaging the process. And security is part of feature sign-off checklist, very, very important item. Any questions so far before we look at other team process improvements?
From where all you get the inputs from the security team?
So from the central security team, because ours is a web application, it's an application server product, right? So there are certain standards, guidelines that are available. For example, any code that you write in certain area, we know it is vulnerable to cross-site scripting. So like code review process has to check those things. So that becomes part of checklist. Like if certain, it's a new area, like if you are, let's say we are trying to implement WebSocket, you know, it's a new protocol. So if you are doing a protocol, you need to get it reviewed by somebody, right, who will actually look at your specification and tells you, okay, what is that you need to really look after and how do you handle issues around that? So, yes.
How do you benchmark that checklist?
How do you benchmark that checklist?
Because you should be sure whether you are covering all the aspects.
Right. So, I think it works three ways in terms of benchmarking. So, obviously, there is no other checklist that is available at our disposal to really benchmark it against. So,
NIST.
Yes, I'm coming to that. So, so that's why I said that there are three ways we do it. The first one is the central security team, and I told you, like, these are a bunch of security experts. So they will provide us input and criteria. So I'm assuming they'll take into consideration all those things when saying that these are the things that you need to look at. The second thing is our own understanding, because coming from a development background, I know at what stage people do make mistakes, right? I know when people have the tendency to check in code without really bothering about how is it going to impact. So those areas I can cover, saying that no, at this point in time, you need to get it reviewed or not, that kind of stuff, right? And with security design, it becomes very easy to get the review process done, right? So those are the areas that I can provide to the team. Engineering development team itself can provide, like, these are the areas we need to have some checks done. And the third is the testing, right? And I explained to you, we were never following testing processes. So the checklist says that, have you run all these tests before you are signing off the feature? And the fourth that we use is, when we don't know whether our checklist is covering this, we have to get a security review done. And we'll ask our central security team, either you do it or we want to get it done from a third party. So it's still an evolving process for us. I said scope for improvement, so it'll be interesting to know your thoughts and ideas. It's nothing cast in stone here.
It has been a wonderful presentation. The one question which is bugging me is, always there is a trade-off between the performance of the application and the security of the application. Okay, how do you balance it when it comes to the performance and the functionalities? Okay, vis-a-vis the security, how many security features you need to build in, how many you need not building, who takes the call?
I take the call. No, I mean, as an engineering head for this product, I have to take that call, and we have not really faced those challenges, to be honest, in this product, because we have not seen performance clashing with security. The only place where it kind of clashed a little bit, where we are trying to do secure by default configuration, because if we provide secure by default configuration, then the performance is slow. But luckily, we have all those as customizable options in the UI interface, so people can turn them off. We are saying, and during install time, we are saying that you install in default mode or secure mode. So there's a choice that we are providing you. And if you install in secure mode, later on you can turn off certain flags that you feel impact the performance of the application. I think to answer your question, I think you have to give choice to the users, make those customizable, saying that you decide, I cannot decide for you, because I want to provide security options, but if you feel they are coming in way of performance, you decide, or may you handle them. I don't have an exact answer for that question.
I was interested in learning about the trainings that you give to your, to your people.
Sure.
There are four levels, and so it's a self-paced learning, or it's an instructor-based training, and do you have in-house product that you use, or you use some industry standard products?
So our centralized security team has created in-house training, and it is, I think, level one and level two is online self-learning exercise. There is no instructor required. And you go through course material, you have to answer the quiz. If you answer all questions correctly, you pass. And this has to be done every year, so you have to do a refresher course. So it's not like you forget about and done with that. So they helped design this course. I don't know what inputs did they use, but it's self. You can do it yourself. I think level 3 and 4, and I was discussing with Shilpi this afternoon during lunchtime. Level 3 is project-based, so you have to actually do a project and then submit it to the security team for analysis. Yes. So that's, I found it very interesting concept, that you have to actually take up a project. And obviously, this is not required for everyone, but this is really required for security czar and stuff like that. You know, you really want to make sure that the people who are dealing with security issues day to day are actually have gone through these training. So obviously severity increases. Like level 2 training will not talk about what is XSS, right? But level 1 training will tell you, okay, what is cross-site scripting and what are the disadvantages, and yeah, I mean those kind of stuff. So that it's more like an awareness thing. So that's how it is.
How do you ensure that people actually do that training? You know, I've seen.
No, because it's an online, so there's a report, so you can actually see what is the percentage that is achieved. It gives you detail and it gives you names also. So it gives you names of the people who have not done that, and it gives you name of the people who have to do a refresh. It sends a reminder also. It's easy, right? It's an online self-paced, right? And if you look at it, I was talking about grading. You're not going to get good grades, right? If the statistics is showing only 60% of the team has done. So as a manager, if I'm the security team will say, sorry, grade D. My target was B, 60%, how can I give you? I'll get it done. So that's the reason I was saying that the grades do become very objective, you know, like, it can really drive you. It's very easy to know, okay, and team does understand, you know, if you tell the team that, you know, we are at F, you know, like that does not make sense, and they will actually help you achieving that.
Yeah, so I have a question.
Sure.
Going back to whatever you had said earlier, when you do threat modeling, you sit along with the client or you brainstorm and you decide one minimum security baseline. But as you said that, when the product is there, it's the onus of the user who would select it if you want something, if you want this type of security or a lower type of security. So would the user be, that smart, that it can, you know, take a call on, okay, I want this security feature, I don't want this security feature. Because all these things, if I'm not wrong, all these things are to be taken while doing threat modeling.
Correct.
You decide.
No, absolutely, very good question. I will cover that sub-part of it later on also, but if you look at this threat model, you can't see this, which circle, even I can't see it, okay, this one, right? So it's a remote data connectivity protocol, and that is outside the sandbox. You can see there's an incoming, right, or bi-directional also. So what we do is, we provide an option saying that we want to keep this communication channel on or off, right? So you decide, right? There is a potential of something coming in here. I'm just giving you an example, right? So you can determine, what are all the vulnerability holes that can exist during threat modeling. And you cannot uncover all, but at a very high architectural level, you can actually cover if you build this and use a data flow diagram. These are the choices that you have to give, and some are very feature specific. You can actually drill down into those features and say that, okay, there are like 5 choices here which can easily provide. But you have to really analyze what is the project that you are building and what is your analysis, and does it make sense to provide that choice to the user?
Cost benefit analysis.
Yes, yes, and also. I think it's better to, and we have realized time and time again, I have realized time and time again working on this product, it is always better to tell users what is happening rather than not tell them and give them something. You know, even if you make it secure by default, if you don't tell them, there is no benefit. Like, please don't do that. You have to tell them, like, there is something that we are building for you. Maybe you don't give them a choice, that's okay, but tell them. If you give them a choice, that's also good. But that communication is very important. And the other part, I will answer you, one of the process improvement that we did was around the hardening guide. So we published a security hardening guide that actually lists out all the possible parameters that are there. So it is for system administrators saying that take the security hardening guide, have fun, right? You can go through all the parameters that are available from security perspective. We are also writing down what they do, what they impact. Use them as you wish. So, sure. Oh, 5 minutes? Okay. So I spoke about this. So we also do a security audit as part of the improvement. And this is just an example of what is the response sometimes that you can get from the auditors. They can rate, find issues and rate on two axes, on severity and on probability of occurrence of an issue. There are multiple ways in which they can do that. This is just an example. I think Albert was talking about when you triage, you can use the potential, future potential. I like that concept. So that is also something interesting. Documentation, this is where I was talking about the new features and security settings should be documented. There should be a separate hardening guide, like security hardening guide. Like if I want to make it like bulletproof, use every possible security setting, I have a guide just focused on that. And then white paper is mostly about if you get a third party review done, do you want to publish those results? And not in a negative way, but because you have fixed those issues, so you want to tell the entire world, right? We got a review done, we fixed all the issues that were reported, and we are good to go, and the third party has certified us, right? That's a good marketing thing, I would do that. Communication, again highlighting, so we started creating new mailing lists. There is a wiki that keeps all the security bugs, white paper, Shilpi maintains a security blog. So that's what I was talking about. You know, from developer, from the team, from security czar, from the product team, there is a security blog. You know, there's an evangelism activity happening around security. And response to security issues is key. The third step that we took at the team level was delivery and notification. We were pathetic, we were F. So we have built an automatic patch notification system with criticality markers. There's a regular patch schedule, so we do a quarterly update and stuff like that. There's a smooth install process, right? If you have to follow like 15 odd instructions, no one is going to apply a patch very quickly, right? But if it is a single click, or if it happens on its own, I think it makes it easier. And also all supported version, because if you're supporting, you've got to support. So in summary, security is increasingly becoming a key differentiator. And hence, there is a need to be proactive. Define assessment criteria, it becomes very objective. You know, categorize and give grades. And set up a security process. I know a lot of security people, I've especially attending this conference, I've realized, and I was talking to Shilpi this morning also, that there are silos that are sometimes exist between the security community and development community, and there's not so much information that actually flows between the two domains, and sometimes that prevents, because developers are the one who actually build the features in the product, and the security job is looked as an outside world thing. And in security domain, if you know, like hardcore things being discussed, and what developers need are really simple, easy stuff that they know they can change when they're checking in their code, to be honest, right? So there has to be some sort of matching that needs to happen. So set up some security process that can match the two sides of it, and have a response plan, very important. If you are making improvements in your product, and if those are not conveyed to your customers, and if those do not help to improve the perception on security of your product, there is no point in investing in security. So that response is very, very important. All right, if there are any questions, I can be reached on my office Adobe mail ID. If there are any questions, I think we got probably time for a couple questions. All right, thank you.